Hi guys, my name is Nishil Kaushal and I am currently interning with the Netflix and company, and today I'll talk about Karta. As we all know, Karta or a manager occupies a very pivotal position in the Hindu joint family. His position is so unique that there is basically no comparable office or institution in any other system in the world. His position in a legal maxim is called sui generis, which is basically called unique. Though he is a person with limited powers, yet within the extent of his sphere, he possesses such vast powers as are possessed by none else. Ordinarily, the senior most member of a family is called as a karta. He does not owe his position to somebody or like an agreement or a person or consent of other co-partners. He is entitled to kartaship because he is the senior most. So as long as he is alive, maybe aged or infirm, he'll hold the position of a karta. So as long as the father is alive, he is a karta. After his death, it passes to another senior most member of the family, who may be the uncle if co-partnery consists of uncles and nephews, or maybe the elder brother if co-partnery consists of brothers. Now, I'll talk about the position of a karta. As I said, the position of a karta is called sui generis, which is called as unique. The relationship between him and other members of the family is not that of a principal or an agent or like partners. As the head of the family, he acts on the behalf of the others, and almost his powers are unlimited. Basically, he is the master of a grand show of joint family and manages its affairs and its business. His powers of management are very wide and almost totalitarian. Though he stands in a fiduciary relationship with other members, he is not a trustee. Ordinarily, he is accountable to none, unless charges of misappropriation or fraud or any conversion are levied against him. He is the master and no one can question him to as what he is received and what he spent. So as long he manages the affairs of the family, he is not bound to save, economize or invest. In short, he is not liable for office position failures, such as failures to invest, to prepare accounts or to save money. He is not bound to pay the income to any of the members, and like in any fixed proportion to other members. He is not bound to treat all members impartially, but he can discriminate one against each other. However despotic his powers may be, but he cannot be despot, as after all he has liabilities towards the members. Any co-person can at any time ask for partition. Now, I'll talk about the liabilities of a karta. Karta's liabilities are numerous and multifarious. Multifarious basically means having different elements. He is responsible to maintain all the members of the family. If he improperly excludes any member for maintenance or does not maintain, then they can file a petition against karta. He is also responsible for the marriage of all unmarried members. This responsibility has been particularly emphasized in respect of the daughters. If a partition suit is filed, he has to prepare the accounts of the members. He represents the family. He has to discharge many responsibilities and liabilities on the behalf of the family. He has to pay taxes and other dues on the behalf of the family, and he can be sued in all office dealings on the behalf of the family with other members, like with the outsiders. Now, I'll talk about the powers of karta. Basically, karta's powers are vast and limitations are very few. It is divided between two parts. For like the extent of his powers is divided between two parts. First, power of alienation and second other powers. Now I'll talk about the powers of alienation. First, powers of management. Karta's powers of management are almost unlimited. He may manage the family affairs and family property and business. He has no liability to save or obligation to save or economize, no obligation to invest funds or to invest them properly. He may discriminate between the members of the family. Like, for example, he may give more to spend, to some less to spend. To some people he may give higher education, to some people he may give additional primary only. To some he may allot a bigger portion of the house to live, to some he may allot some small portion to live. But he cannot deny maintenance or use and occupation of property to other members. Second is a right to income. It is a natural consequence of joint family system that all the income of joint family property should be brought to the common chest. All incomes of the joint family property, whosoever may be, collect them. A co-partner, an agent or a servant must be handed over to the karta. Unless the karta has specified allotted income to a particular property to a member, no member of the Hindu joint family is entitled to any definite share of the income of the joint family property or business. It is for the karta to allot funds to the members and to look after their needs and requirements. So as long as the members and to look after the needs of the requirements, so as the family remains joint, no member can ask for a specified income, specified shared in the income. Third, right to representation. The karta represents the family in all matters such as legal, social and religious. He acts on the behalf of the family and his acts are binding to the entire joint family. The karta can enter into any transaction on behalf of the family and it will be binding on the joint family. He represents the family in suits and other legal proceedings. The joint family will be bound by a decree or order passed in the legal proceedings. Even when the karta has a loss of case on account of his gross negligence, it is not open to the other members to have the decree set aside on the ground alone. Now, fourth, the power of compromise. The karta has a power to compromise all his disputes relating to the family property or their management. He can also compromise family debts and other transactions. However, if the act of compromise is not bona fide, in a good faith, then it can be challenged in a petition. The karta has no right to give up a substantial proportion of debt due to the family merely out of charity or sympathy. Power of acknowledgement. The karta has power to acknowledge on behalf of the family and debt due to family. He also has the power to pay interest on a debt or to make part payment on the principal so that a fresh period of limitation may start. Now, karta's power to contract debts. The karta has an implied authority to contract debts and pledge the credit of the property of the family for ordinary purposes of the family business. Such debts incurred in the ordinary course of business are binding on the entire family. The karta of non-business joint Hindu family has also the powers to contract debts for the family purposes. Now, karta's power to enter into contracts. The karta has the power to enter into contracts and such contracts are binding on the family. Now, some questions. First, can a junior male member be a karta of the family? Yes, he can be a karta of the family if it is by understanding or agreement or among co-partner that a junior male member can be a co-partner. Second, can there be more than one karta? Yes, there can be more than one karta. Third, can a female be the karta of a joint family? So basically, at one time, the Nagpur High Court held the view that the mother, though not a co-partner, can be held karta of the family if there are no male adult members. But in the case of Income Tax versus Seth Govind Ram, the Supreme Court in accordance said that the mother cannot be the karta of the family, as it is with accordance with the text of Hindu law. Thank you.